Good day, everyone. This is Dr. Soper here, and today I'll be presenting a complete walkthrough of a QLearning-based AI system in Python. The content of this lesson builds directly upon the concepts that were discussed in the previous video in this series, so if you're unfamiliar with QLearning, I would highly recommend that you watch the previous video before watching this video. Let's begin by introducing the business problem that we'll be solving in this lesson. Imagine that a growing e-commerce company is building a new warehouse, and that the company would like all of the picking operations in the new warehouse to be performed by warehouse robots. In case you're unfamiliar, warehouse robots are autonomous ground vehicles that are designed to automatically handle many common warehouse-related tasks, such as picking. In the context of e-commerce warehousing, picking is the task of gathering individual items from various locations in the warehouse in order to fulfill customer orders. After picking items from the shelves, the e-commerce company would like the robots to bring the items to a specific location within the warehouse where the items can be packaged for shipping. In order to ensure maximum efficiency and productivity, the robots will need to learn the shortest path between the packaging area and all of the other locations within the warehouse where the robots are allowed to travel. Our goal in this video will be to use QLearning to accomplish this task. As a quick refresher, remember that the first task when designing a QLearning system is to define the environment. The environment consists of states, actions, and rewards. The AI agent will use the states and rewards as inputs and will generate actions as outputs. Let's briefly discuss the states for our warehouse robot scenario. First, consider that our e-commerce company's warehouse can be represented as a diagram, as shown here. In the diagram, each black square represents an item storage location, such as a shelf or a storage bin. Each white square in the diagram is part of an aisle that the robots can use to travel throughout the warehouse. Finally, the green square in the diagram indicates the location of the item packaging area. Next, note that each of the 121 locations in the warehouse represents a state, or situation in which a robot might find itself at a particular point in time. Each state can be identified by a row and a column index. The item packaging area, for example, is at location 0, 5. Also note that the black and green squares are terminal states. This means that if our AI agent decides to drive a robot into one of these areas while it is being trained, then that training episode will be finished. In the case of the green square, our AI agent will have achieved its goal, but in the case of any of the black squares, the AI agent will have failed, since it will have crashed the robot into an item storage area. This sort of failure is conceptually identical to falling down the cliff in the famous cliff walking example that we discussed in the previous video in this series. Next, let's briefly discuss actions. The actions that are available to the AI agent in our scenario are simply to move the robot in one of four directions: up, right, down, or left. Again, the AI agent will need to learn to choose actions that will prevent the robot from crashing into the item storage areas. Finally, let's discuss the reward structure for our scenario. To help the AI agent learn, each state, or location, in the warehouse is assigned a reward value. The agent may begin at any white square, but regardless of where the agent begins, its goal is always the same: to maximize its total rewards. Note that in this scenario, negative rewards, that is, punishments, are being used for all states except the goal. This encourages the AI to identify the shortest path to the goal by minimizing its punishments. You might be wondering why we don't use positive rewards for the white squares. Well, remember that the AI agent's goal is always to maximize its cumulative rewards. If we were to use positive rewards for the white squares, then the agent could simply drive around on the white squares forever and accumulate a very large cumulative reward, even if it never reaches the goal. By using negative rewards, the agent receives a small punishment for each step that it takes, and so to minimize its punishments, it will try to reach the item shipping location by taking the fewest steps possible from its current location. The result, of course, will be the shortest path from the current location to the goal. Now that we're familiar with our scenario and with the states, actions, and rewards that will define the environment, let's switch to Python and take a look at some code. Before I begin describing the code in this notebook, I'd just like you to know that a link to this notebook is available in the video description. Please feel free to download a copy of the notebook to play with, or to adapt to your own needs. I've also included most of the information that we just discussed about the scenario and the environment in the notebook. Hopefully this will prove useful if we need a reminder from time to time as we're working through the notebook. As usual, the first thing that we'll do is import the required Python libraries. We'll just need one library for this project, NumPy, which we'll use to create a few multidimensional arrays, generate some random values, and perform some other numeric tasks. Our first major task in this project, and indeed in any reinforcement learning project, is to define the environment. Let's begin with the states. Recalling that our warehouse can be represented by a grid, let's define the dimensions of that grid. In this scenario, we have 11 rows and 11 columns, yielding 121 possible states, or locations. Next, let's use NumPy to define a three-dimensional array. We'll be using this array to hold all of our Q values for the project. If you recall from the last video in this series, we'll have one Q value for each combination of a state and an action. The first two dimensions will therefore represent the rows and columns that define our states, while the third dimension will contain one element for each possible action that the AI agent might take while in a particular state. Note that we're using NumPy's zeros function to initialize all of our Q values to zero. Next, we'll define the four actions that our AI agent may take: up, right, down, and left. Based on its index location in the actions list, each action will be associated with a numeric code. 0 will mean up, 1 will mean right, 2 will mean down, and 3 will mean left. Now we can define the last element of our environment, the rewards. Each state in the environment has a reward value, so we can use a two-dimensional array to hold the reward values for each location within the environment. Let's begin by first creating an appropriately sized two-dimensional array and initializing all of the array values to negative 100. We're beginning with all of the values set to negative 100 because the majority of the squares in the warehouse are black and hence have a reward value of negative 100. Next, we're setting the reward for the packaging area, that is, the goal, to 100. Note that the packaging area is located at row 0, column 5. The next task is to construct a dictionary named aisles, whose keys will be the indexes of all of the rows in the warehouse that contain at least one white square, and whose values will be a list containing the column indexes for each white square within a particular row. This is a bit of a cumbersome task, but we need to do this in order to specify the reward values for all of the white squares in the warehouse. Finally, we can use a set of nested for loops to iterate through our dictionary and set the reward values for all of the white squares in the warehouse to -1. We then print the results to the screen so that we can verify that the reward values were specified correctly. Congratulations! Our environment is now fully configured and we can proceed to the second major task in our project, which is for our AI agent to learn about its environment by implementing a QLearning model. The learning process will follow these steps. First, we'll choose a random, non-terminal state, that is, a white square, for the agent to begin a new episode. Second, the AI agent will choose an action, that is, to move up, right, down, or left, for the current state. Actions will be chosen using what is known as an epsilon greedy algorithm. This algorithm will usually choose the most promising action for the AI agent, but it will occasionally choose a less promising option in order to encourage the agent to explore the environment. Third, the AI agent will perform the chosen action and transition to the next state. That is, it will move to the next location. Fourth, the agent will receive the reward for moving to the new state and will calculate the temporal difference value associated with that movement. The agent will then update the Q value for the previous state and action pair. If the new, that is the current state, is a terminal state, then we'll loop back to number 1 and start a new training episode. If not, then we'll loop back to number 2 and continue the current training episode. This entire process will be repeated across 1,000 episodes. This will provide the AI agent sufficient opportunity to learn the shortest paths between the item packaging area and all other locations in the warehouse where the robot is allowed to travel, while simultaneously learning to avoid crashing into any of the item storage locations. Let's begin this part of the project by defining a few helper functions that will perform some useful tasks for our AI agent. The first function determines if the state at the specified row and column location is a terminal state. It figures this out simply by looking at the reward for the specified state. If the reward is equal to -1, then the state is not a terminal state. That is, it is a white square. Otherwise, the state must be a terminal state. That is, a black or green square. This next function simply chooses a random starting location for a new training episode. The function just continues choosing random row and column indexes until it identifies a non-terminal state to use as the next starting location. This next function implements the epsilon greedy algorithm in order to choose the AI agent's next action. This function works by checking whether a random number between 0 and 1 is less than the epsilon value, which in our project will be 0.9 or 90%. If so, then the algorithm will select the action with the largest Q value for the current state. Recalling from our previous lesson that Q values represent our current estimate of the sum of all future rewards if we were to take a particular action in a particular state, this means that our epsilon greedy algorithm will choose what appears to be the most promising action 90% of the time. For the remaining 10% of the time, it will choose a random action. This mechanism encourages the AI agent to explore its environment by occasionally choosing a less promising action. Our next function simply gets the next location in the warehouse, given the current location, and the selected action. For example, if we're currently located at row index 5 and column index 3, and we want to move up, this function will return the location at row index 4, column index 3. Finally, our last helper function returns a list that contains the shortest path between the specified starting location and the item packaging location in the warehouse. After we've trained our model, we'll be able to call this function to see what the AI agent has learned about how to move within the warehouse. Let's run this cell to make all of these functions available to our program. Now we've reached the most exciting part of our project, the part where we'll actually train our AI agent using QLearning. We begin by defining a few parameters that will guide the training process. First is epsilon, which will be used in conjunction with our epsilon greedy algorithm. Epsilon specifies the percentage of time when we should take the best action when we're in a state, rather than taking a random action. Next is the discount factor. This will be used when we're calculating temporal difference values to specify by how much we should discount future rewards. Finally, we specify the learning rate. This will control how quickly the AI agent learns. As noted earlier, our AI agent will learn by running through 1,000 training episodes, and we're using a for loop for that purpose. The first thing that we'll do at the beginning of each training episode is to call the getStartingLocation function in order to get the location of the white square where the AI agent should begin the episode. We then set up a while loop, which will continue running until the AI agent moves into one of the terminal locations. Remember that the item packaging area and all of the item storage locations are terminal states, so if the agent reaches the packaging area or crashes into one of the item storage locations, the current training episode will end immediately. Each iteration of the while loop represents one step in the warehouse, so the first thing that we do at the beginning of each iteration is to call the getNextAction function to determine in which direction the AI agent should move next. Remember, actions are movements up, right, down, or left. We next store the current location and then call the getNextLocation function in order to move to the next location, based on the chosen action. After we arrive at the new location, we get the immediate reward for moving to that location, and then compute the temporal difference value associated with our latest move by using the temporal difference formula that we discussed in the previous video in this series. Finally, we update the Q value for the previous state and action based on what we've learned after moving to our current location. The new Q value is calculated using the Bellman equation that we discussed in our previous video. And that's it! We've just implemented a complete QLearning-based AI system in Python. Let's run this code cell and train our AI agent. Now that our agent is fully trained, we can call the getShortestPath function to get the shortest path that the agent identified between any white square in the warehouse and the item packaging location. Let's see a few examples. As you can see, the function gives us all of the steps on the shortest path between the starting location and the item packaging location. For the sake of clarity, let's visualize one of these paths. Say the path that starts at row 9, column 5. As shown on the diagram, the AI agent has identified the shortest path between the two points, and has successfully learned to avoid crashing into any of the item storage locations. This is just one example, but if we were to check, we would find the same is true for every other possible starting location in the warehouse. Pretty awesome. Finally, it's great that our robot can automatically take the shortest path from any legal location in the warehouse to the item packaging area, but what about the opposite scenario? Put differently, our robot can currently deliver an item from anywhere in the warehouse to the packaging area, but after it delivers the item, it will need to travel from the packaging area to another location in the warehouse to pick up the next item. Don't worry, this problem is easily solved simply by reversing the order of the shortest path. Let's run the last code cell to see an example. As you can see, if we need the robot to go from the item packaging area to the location at row 5, column 2, we just need to reverse the path. Our AI system can thus direct a warehouse robot to pick an item from anywhere in the warehouse and bring that item to the packaging area, and then send the robot from the packaging area to anywhere else in the warehouse to pick the next item. This is definitely cool stuff. Well, there you have it. A complete example of QLearning in Python, from start to finish. I hope that you're beginning to appreciate just how useful QLearning can be, and that perhaps you've begun thinking about how you could apply QLearning to solve other types of business problems. In the next video in this series, we'll continue our adventures in cognitive computing and artificial intelligence by introducing artificial neural networks and deep QLearning. So be sure to come back soon. Well, my friends, thus ends our complete walkthrough of a QLearning-based AI system in Python. I hope that you learned something interesting in this lesson, and until next time, have a great day.